the next subject, which is timeless parameters. And timeless parameters is this idea that you can use for evaluation, and it has its basis in these four principles, along with six more principles. The first one being a transition between these four principles, which has to do with timelessness, and then the other five principles, which has to do with self-knowledge. And so the importance of self-knowledge is a fifth parameter. The first four parameters are similar to the four principles. It's like everything is interconnected, is the first parameter. And you can kind of evaluate if you're listening to someone speak, or you're observing or reading a teaching, or you're trying to determine if this is reliable, then you can sometimes look for these things, or at least pay attention to when someone says something that appears to contradict this. And one of them is then that everything is interconnected, and another is that the second one is that everything is made up of opposites, and that we therefore need to value opposite, not just like only value consciousness. Well, we shouldn't value unconsciousness necessarily, but like this, the things are also kind of material. Well, I don't know. Is it possible to also value unconsciousness? Something to think about. I mean, if consciousness and unconsciousness creates a duality, then at least for the sake of having more patience with people who are unconscious, then perhaps we should not demonize unconsciousness too much, but we have to recognize it as kind of the problem. Well, I don't want to philosophize and get stuck on that right now, but basically there are people who value the mind or spirituality more than the material. And the material, there are people who value the material and possession and success and this more than like consciousness. And so we need to have a balance between things. That's basically the point of the second parameter. And the third parameter is that everything is always moving, and that also implies that there is no ultimate goal. We have to be careful when it comes to trying to achieve a permanent state. And this risk of boredom, if we can predict things, it relates to this idea of surprise that I view as a little bit of the meaning of life or existence. And then the fourth parameter is that things resemble each other on different scales. You can use that when it comes to trying to understand the world more. That you don't like make the mistake of thinking that something is completely different because it is on a different scale. I'm sorry, I can't think of a good example right now, but that's basically, this is just a summary of what I remember. And it's true, I kind of struggle a little bit with remembering what I wrote about that in terms of timeless parameters. But I mean, I have used that when I like examine religions and what is similar between religions and things like that, so that people do not understand that religions are just like completely opposites. But at the same time, they are not identical either, but there is certain things that if you look at them in a certain way, often they correspond. And so that is something that I include as one of these parameters. And then the importance of these like timeless principles and self-knowledge is like a fifth parameter to look for. And then the sixth parameter is consciousness, this idea of the fact that we should not be identified, because who are we? That is a good question to ask. Who are you and what do you want? But who are you has to do with identity. And while what do you want has more to do with like goal and this idea of fixation. A person is so obsessed or fixated or partial about something that when you ask them what do they want, and if they answer this thing that they are partial towards, and then you ask them, okay, but when you have that, what do you want then, and things like that, you can you can use that question to have people realize that perhaps they don't know what they want, or they don't know what they want with what they want, and things like that. And loosen up their rigid fixation on getting one particular thing, like you know, a nationalist might think that once our country become nationalistic, everything will be good. But is that really the end of their desiring things? I mean, there is always something new popping up, and if people are honest with themselves, they are going to realize that they will never be satisfied. There will always be things to improve, always be things to add to your life. And so in the end, the best way is to like go the opposite way, to just not want anything. And by not wanting anything, you can like appreciate what you have. Like right now, I'm just sitting here, it's kind of cool. But it's kind of neat at the same time. I'm seeing deers run by, you know, didn't expect to see that, but it's kind of neat. You gain more when you become receptive, and you become receptive by not being too focused on things. So that has to do with those questions and who are you. And if you ask yourself that, you often arrive at the conclusion that you don't really know what you are. You're just some kind of aware knower that cannot really be defined, and that has to do with consciousness, and that has to do with self-knowledge, and that is the purest spiritual aspect of self-knowledge. But there are other aspects of self-knowledge, and one of them has to do with our sort of nature that has been given to us, or which we are stuck in, or which we are using as a kind of vehicle or fuel that drives us around, that we are running on. And this has to do with these energy factors that can be categorized as types, for example. But basically they are divided into three parts, and one of them is the intellect or thinking, like the conceptualization and things we dream about and things like that. And in order to deal with that, we need to deal with epistemology. Like if we want to know things, we have to have some solid foundation with that. So that is one parameter to see if people are realistic about what they base their knowledge on, where they set out from, so to speak, their foundation. And then, and also seeking, to be open to seeking, and have this value of seeking truth. And then we have the second layer, which is the emotions, feelings, and this has to do with self-control and kindness, developing kindness, and to be honest with ourselves that we are not kind, and that it is very difficult to be kind, and also to not expect people to be kind simply by telling them to be kind. You cannot order people. You have to educate them and give them incentives to develop kindness, sort of. But kindness is still important as a value, because if you don't have kindness, then then you can't complain if people are cruel to you, so to speak. And then the third layer of that, which goes along with the ninth principle, the parameter, timeless parameter, is authenticity and your basic desire and the sort of sensory motor level of your human body or human energy, life energy. And that has to do with authenticity and to not get stuck too much in routine. And authenticity is so important for speaking truth and developing truth, awareness of truth. If we are not authentic, we can fit in more easily if we are not authentic. But it comes at the expense of truth. And suddenly people think that when everyone conforms, that is the natural thing, because people are too cowardly, or perhaps not even cowardly, but just simply unaware of who they are or what they really want. It is possible for people to repress their authentic feelings without even knowing about it, and so that is kind of a serious thing to to look for, and that we need to really, really take this seriously, this idea of being authentic. So that is one parameter, and then the final 10th parameter is like the physical, the fact that we are in physical bodies. We cannot simply dismiss that. If the situation, if we were meant to live in a different state, then why is that not our state? So this idea that we, as illusory or distorted as our understanding of the world may be, we still need to take it a little bit seriously, the fact that perhaps there is some point to the fact that we are looking at things like animals, that we are living our lives and often fall into this kind of animal state, and that we want physical things, that perhaps there is some kind of meaning in that, even if it is just surprise or variation, that perhaps originally we were disembodied spirits or something in some other region, and we desired something interesting to pass the time, and then we influenced evolution to create bodies suitable to spirits, so that we could have limitations and surprises and dangers imposed upon us, so that we could have a feeling like being on a roller coaster or watching a movie or something, like we are trying to be entertained now. Like, it's like, I think that boredom is a serious thing to consider philosophically. Like, perhaps danger is a blessing sometimes, because boredom might be a even worse killer. You know, there's a lot of things that you can philosophize regarding that. And what I said now might sound weird. Like, if once we were disembodied spirits, well, it's just a mind exercise. Like, just think about that for a moment. Even if it's not true, you know, can you imagine yourself being just a disembodied spirit? Perhaps that wouldn't be so fun after a while. But of course, if you don't believe in spirits, and if you believe that this is your only life and things like that, and you are completely a material person, then I guess it is more difficult to argue for the merit of surprise and things like that. But you know, I there are other aspects of timeless education that are meant to question this idea of pure materialism, and this idea that the physical is all there is. But I will be getting to that later. So that is something that there are, like, different aspects of timeless education are meant for different things. And now the sun is almost completely gone, and I think that I will continue this perhaps tomorrow, or perhaps indoors. But the next concept is creational causality. So let me just try to address that as well.